If you just look at the University Act statutes and regulations, there is provision right from the Board of Management. There is provision for inducting people from the industry and other sectors. Looking at the Central University Act, we can see that even in the Board of Management, there has to be 5 members from outside the university system, 5 members out of 12. And this nomination is being done by, of course, for our central universities, this nomination is done by none other than the visitor of the university, the President of India. It is very specifically mentioned, industry, other sectors, IT, and eminent experts in the Board of Management. In the University Act, in the Academic Council and Board of Studies, nobody prevents the university in taking expertise from the industry. There is provision. I have, State University Act, Central University Act, all these things. There is provision. In the Academic Council, in the Board of Management, there is provision for that. Why it is not happening? That's a question of. So there is lot of, we cannot blame the system for everything. It is for us to just induct people and get expertise. And nobody prevents a university teacher, a university vice chancellor, or a head of a department, or a teacher who is teaching that particular subject to get networked with an industry, with a corporate expert, with a civil society organization and get their inputs. And universities should be open to ideas, open to strategies, open to people and open to places. I think if this is not happening, I think we have to have some sort of an introspection. I think there are universities doing it, such things. There are universities not doing it, or this power of the university, this power of the academic is being usurped by somebody else. People should have courage to say that and then do it. There is provision.
Because I know it's for certain, that's why.
Talk of online education. Have we achieved some success in the recent past in making students and parents and faculty members comfortable up with the concept of online education?
Well, I have one question. Hello, I have one question.
Okay, we have taken questions.
Yeah. See, is there any possible, an economics point of view, do you see in the, next maybe couple of years, education or maybe as a factor, as an aggregate, as a separate, macroeconomic aggregate, contributing to the GDP or GNP?
A separate thing,
Any other question?
I have an input to this discussion. It's not a question, so if you want me to say it right now, tell me. Okay. I'm Atul from Harrison Assessments. I had a similar question in the school track yesterday. From the discussion today and yesterday also, I've gotten a feeling that people, or maybe sometimes audiences also, have a lesser knowledge about behavioral sciences, and that's what the company is all about, Harrison Assessment. And we are too, definitely, the entire ICT is being used for creating content or whatever around physical sciences, let us say a subject like physics or geography or history or maths or whatever it is. Now, two of our speakers over here mentioned that, and I'm glad you did. Professor Sehgal, who mentioned about more holistic development of the child in terms of the education system enabling the child to be an innovator, to be a creator in terms of creativity skills, or somebody mentioned he's written a book on core values. Now, these are very behavioral, non-technical, touchy-feely topics. But for the benefit of everybody, last 30 to 50 years, in terms of behavioral sciences, there has been enough research that says that all of these behaviors can today be measured. So if you want to know your innovation index, there is a way to measure that. If you want to know your creativity index, there is a tool to measure that. Every behavior that you can think about or define can today be measured, and there are tools for that. Everything. I'm giving you an example of something very common to India or relevant to India, integrity. How probable is it that a person would have high integrity or medium integrity or low integrity? We can measure that. From K-12 segment itself, from 8th class onwards itself. And all of this information can be used for various things, for career decisioning. Now, a person who's got a little bit less score on integrity for sure needn't be in a, you know, line of career which requires him to be very highly like that. Similarly, there was another mention of by Brigadier Garewal, who said, teach how to think. Now, there is a mandate in the CBSE curriculum, which is the CCE report card, which measures thinking skills. Not measures, but measures in terms of more subjective, that the teacher assesses the student in terms of thinking skills. Today, there is a tool to measure that too. We can measure a student's, an 8th class student's thinking skills, emotional skills, social skills, let it be any behavior in the world. We can measure that. So that input that we could all utilize.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for the inputs. I think this is the last.
Hello. My name is Sanjay Gadale. I run a management consulting firm, and I do advise a number of universities as well as educational establishments, both in the commercial as well as the non-commercial sectors. My basic contention here, after going through this entire presentation, though in part, is that you can only teach a person who is willing to learn. What we are achieving over here through all these platforms is essentially an information overload. A potential recipient. There is no way we are ensuring that this content that is conveyed to the recipient, willingly, unwillingly, unwittingly, wittingly, whatever it is, the way you would like to position it, is actually going to get absorbed. I agree, tend to agree extensively with Mr. Garewal, I think. I'm sorry if I got your rank wrong, sir. Brigadier? Yeah. Learning is something which is a two-way process, and it has to be acceptable, and it has to actually get blended. All these platforms are only tools which will allow you to transfer an amount of content across to the end recipient. But finally, I would to a certain extent disagree with you when you say that there are shades and grays of integrity which will be allowed in various jobs. I mean, that is a story which is either it's a go or a no-go. There is no particular job in this world which I can come across, even in your own life, where you can compromise in integrity. I think that is more of a subjective story. We can leave it for another session. The thing is that unless and until we actually come out with a solution which is using the strengths of both these platforms and also Pan-IIT discussion group as well, the current way in which engineering education also is trying to get delivered across, which is totally based on bookish knowledge, which is non-Socrates linked, that is learning by doing, is basically yielding us a huge army of clerks who basically, if an engineer, a so-called engineer is given a screwdriver, I don't think he's in a position to even repair something inside the house, correct a switch which is broken down. Now, unless and until we address these key areas, all this content is just going to be there, which is already there. If I do a Wikipedia, yes, the reliability of the content has to be again vouched, and other things have to be there. But 99%, I will give benefit of the doubt. The content is good enough to be able to be adopted and worked on with. But till this entire August gathering and panel gets it into its entire act, that what is more important today is the delivery system and the social sort of a linkage that is given to education for achieving an end result, I think we will just be creating more and more silos of content, which will basically lie there as a huge repository.
I think.
Thank you.
There is no need of answering this question. These are all very, no, there is no question of debate on such points. Of course, there is a lot of education and knowledge development happening outside the university system. We all are from the university system. I sincerely believe that there is a lot of education, knowledge development, learning happening in outside the university system, maybe several hundred times. How these capabilities of the corporate sector, the civil society organizations, even public participation is not really happening. For example, when we talk about education, we are thinking only about the Ministry of Human Resource Department of the Government of India, as well as the state education departments. There are a lot of education opportunities in other departments as well. For example, maybe technology, maybe the lot of other sectors. Rural development, there are ample examples. What is required is, for example, when we consider the leadership and change in our university approaches, what is required is an openness to identify such educational capabilities and educational infrastructure available outside the formal confines of the universities and colleges in this country, and then try to make use of that facility. Unless and until we do that, we may not be able to provide education and knowledge to millions of people who are hungry for education, who are hungry for development. And unless and until we address that issue, we will be definitely failing in our duties. Of course, I am an incorrigible optimist. We are all doing it. That shows the interest. I see in this conference itself, 90% of the participants are not from the education system, but from the other sectors. There is a lot of interest. There is a lot of enthusiasm among the non-conventional university systems or systems outside the university area, and what's the responsibility of our responsibility, the university's responsibility, is to identify credible partnership with such civil society organizations, corporates, public sector, private sector, and then put all our efforts together for providing education and skills to millions of people. And that should be the university's contribution to the knowledge economy. Thank you very much.